I think we'll get started here. Welcome to Nangola. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Caitlin and I'm from Valerie, so not too far over the divide here. And I work for Saskatchewan Prairie Conservation Action Plan, or PCAP for short. And we have a mandate to do the Native Prairie Speaker Series, so we try to travel around to different communities in southwest Saskatchewan over the course of the year. I think we were in Mancota a year or two ago for invasive species talk, and last time we were here at the Grasslands Inn, it was about snakes, and they actually brought snakes, so that's pretty cool. No badgers today, though, sorry. but we're in for a real treat. I've already seen the presentation, it's awesome. So hopefully it answers all of your questions about badgers. I should mention too that we're going to try to record our presentation and put it up on our YouTube channel, so if you know someone that would have enjoyed hearing about it, then you can refer them to it. It'll probably take me a couple of days to get it up there. We often do presentations by webinar, and you can check out our website to learn more about ones that are coming up. And I'll just mention that we have one coming up on Thursday about coyotes and what kind of food they like to eat. And then we also have one coming up at the end of March about pronghorn. So if you ever want to learn more about those species, then you can check out our website to register for the webinar, or else shortly afterwards it'll be on the YouTube channel there. Before we begin, I'd like to state that we respectfully acknowledge that we're on the traditional territories of many Indigenous nations and communities, past and present. For millennia, they have worked to protect these landscapes and the life these areas sustain. I'd like to thank these original caretakers and acknowledge the ongoing work and presence of Indigenous peoples in Canada today. I'd also like to take a moment to note that financial support for today's presentation is provided by Environment and Climate Change Canada. And there's been support from NCC and the Southern Alberta Land Trust Society. And so today's presenter is Nikki Heim, a wildlife ecologist. So Nikki's been working in the field of natural resource sciences for over 20 years. She doesn't look that old, I'm kidding. I know! throughout Western Canada as well as the Northwestern United States. She held roles in terrestrial wildlife ecology, focusing on understanding population dynamics of medium to large sized carnivores and promoting wildlife coexistence. Nikki completed a Master of Science examining the cumulative impacts to wolverines and the carnivore community in the central Rocky Mountains. And Nikki was first introduced to badgers as a technician on a research project in central British Columbia. Nikki currently resides in Canmore, Alberta, where she enjoys spending time on the interface of mountain and prairie landscapes. So with that, I'll pass it over to you, Nikki.
Badgers did enter my life several years ago as an assistant when I worked on a research project. I really knew nothing about badgers at all. I spent a lot of my childhood in the mountains, not in the grasslands, and then I had this opportunity to kind of get immersed in the grasslands to start in BC and learn more about badgers. The project, which we'll talk a little bit about later, was the first one to try and put GPS backpacks on badgers, because you can't collar them to monitor them if their necks got to and they just pop them off. So because of that, I had a lot of opportunity to handle them and watch their movements, watch them hunt, watch them around the landscape. So that's kind of where that started. Okay, we'll dive in. So for those of you, most of you, I'm sure this is what you commonly see, is a striped little face with a huge dirt pile in front of it. This is a badger. And so just the topics tonight, this is a prairie weasel. It is a member of the weasel family. I'll talk about that a little bit. Just go over the distribution and status. What are the benefits of badgers? Some ecology and fun facts around badgers. A little bit of true or false. And I'm going to touch on the threats, the leading threats to badgers. And then living with badgers. So what are some of the best management practices around badgers? see is, and you probably know this, badgers are highly adapted for digging. So everything about their physical makeup describes a little digging machine. They've got a really blunt face, short legs, short ears, and a rounded face. So it just allows them to be burrowing under the ground quite easily. Their claws, if you've seen them, they're quite long, and I think for some, they might seem kind of threatening because of these long claws. The long claws are designed for digging. That is their primary tool for digging. They rarely use them for attack or defense. That's usually their teeth. And so if you see a badger's claws, they're usually pretty rounded from all that digging. And so as I mentioned, they do spend most of their lives underground digging burrow networks, or referred to as sets. Some of these networks can be single or extend, like 9 feet into the ground or 7 feet across. They use these sets for everything from their life history. So for resting, reproduction, safety, security, rearing their young or their kids. So these burrow networks are really vital to their survival as well. And you'll also see from a safety perspective, if the badger feels threatened, right away they're going down into their burrow. Unless you corner them, they can't get to their burrow. But their burrow is their safe place. And if you hang around that burrow long enough, you may see that they backfill the burrow. It's a little spit dirt back in your face. And kind of like closing a door. I don't want that anymore. And one fun fact is they are considered the only true burrowing predator in Canada. So, for those of you who haven't seen one or feel like seeing one again, this is just a really short clip of the badger moving through the prairie. So you can see they've got pretty short legs, they're pretty low to the ground. Really, really well. They can stick really close to their burrows. Okay, so the distribution of status and status of this, so badgers that you see on the prairie are considered American badgers, opposed to the European badger, the African badger, the North American or American badgers, the common name is the badger we have here. There's four subspecies of badger throughout North America. There's the Jeffersoni, Texas, Jeffersoni, and I actually pronounced that last one wrong. But so we have mainly Jeffersoni, subspecies Texas, and Jeffersoni. So the two populations that are out east and out west, so Ontario, British Columbia, those subspecies are listed as readily endangered. There's not as much grassland habitat in those parts of the country, and a lot of that grassland habitat has been developed where there's a lot of highways and road networks where there's a lot of mortality for these species, so they're not doing as well kind of on both sides of the prairies. The subspecies, Texidia, Texas, which is the prairie badger, all the badgers you find where you live, prairies here, are listed as species of special concern. This information is fairly outdated at this point. There's not a lot of information on them. They're pretty cryptic species. We don't see them. There's not a lot of monitoring going on for them. So federally, they're listed as species of special concern because of the lack of information on them. And their numbers have gone down over time throughout history, largely with the change of native prairie to cropland and other and roads and development. But within the prairies, they are kind of considered data deficient because there's that lack of information on them. So today, right now, there's no available population estimate on badgers across the prairies. And in some regions, I come from Alberta, and there's definitely some indication of people that are saying they're not seeing them as much. So there was some indication that they are declining, but that's a real question mark. Okay, so why are we talking about badgers? What are the badgers are really considered as kind of key contributors and indicators of healthy grasslands. So often if you have badgers living in that grassland, they're contributing to the health by some of their ecology and their behavior, and I'll go into that. And they're a really good indication of a healthy functioning grassland. So first off, one of the big benefits in contributors to this healthy grassland system is they're very effective grassland predators, particularly on small mammal populations. So you've got, they really reduce the impact of excessive foraging of species like small mammals. So you've got ground squirrels that kind of gone unchecked, so you probably know they can really make a dent in vegetative communities, a lot of voles. So your badgers won't eliminate them entirely, but they can regulate and bring down those numbers quite a bit. So in regulating those small mammal populations, just to give you an idea of what that looks like or that means, they're estimated to consume about 2 to 3 ground squirrels per day. When in the area, they can reduce populations up to about 50%. And the figure that I have just come to learn is about 300 prairie dogs equals 1 AUM, or about 1 cow-calf pair. So kind of giving an idea of what a badger can remove from giving that vegetative biomass back, I guess. Another thing that has come to my attention in more recent was a paper of a woman who was studying Gunnison's prairie dogs down in New Mexico. And while she was studying these prairie dogs, she had a single female badger come into her study colony. And so she began to observe this female badger, and she published a paper talking about the predation on her study species as relentless and devastating effect on her. The prey species. I've never seen that wording used in a research paper, so that was quite funny. I think she's pretty upset that the badger came and annihilated her study population. But she did report that between June and July, this single badger is about 33 days, I think it was. She watched 100 kill events by the single badger in 33. Pretty substantial. So as I mentioned, they are regulators of small mammal populations and species. So these are kind of their preferred prey, or rodents, small mammals. But they are fairly opportunistic, so you will find them predating on rattlesnakes, muskrats, where you have them, they can clear out a nest of eggs. But you won't see them persisting really anywhere without that small mammal population that is their primary prey. So just to describe their habitat types, I'm probably very familiar with this, but out of the prairies, they prefer kind of parkland, mixed grass prairie, full desert. They do often kind of move through cultivated fields, but these are the systems they prefer to be in. And they're very much tied to friable soils and that availability that preferred prey or small mammals. Now, when I'm saying friable soils, basically soils that you can dig, but there's enough structure in the soil that the burrows aren't going to collapse. So another key contributor is they're such effective digging machines. They can often be referred to as ecosystem engineers. So they're really engineering their environment for their own benefit. So then that in turn gives a lot of benefits back to the system. Through that digging and mixing, they kind of create microclimates, microsites, and benefit a lot of other species in the process. So saying that, they're sometimes considered a keystone species, creating a lot of habitat, mainly burrows for animals that rely on burrows. And underground tunnel systems so that they don't dig them on their own. So two species of obligate secondary users, so users that really rely on these burrows but don't dig them on their own, are swift fox and burrowing owl. This is endangered federally. So Oh, and I thought I'd share with you, this has come out in a recent report at the federal level, but the Species at Risk Act, they've come up with a list of all the species at risk, 27 of them, that are really reliant upon burrows created by badgers. So this ranges from everything from burrowing owls, as I mentioned, swift fox, to western toads, rattlesnakes, rubber boas, short-eared owls, woodpecker, mariposa lily. So there's a really wide range of species that rely upon badgers in the system. So kind of going back to that ecosystem engineer and all that digging that they like to do, that digging really improves soil aeration, turns over the soil, it improves water filtration, can really increase nutrient cycling, so pulling nutrients from topsoil, going down to the VC horizon, soil horizon layer, so really pulling that through. It improves vascular plant diversity, soil and vertebrate diversity, terrestrial vertebrate diversity. So kind of in short, they all of that diversity and the improved aeration, water infiltration, nutrient cycling, and improves the resilience and resistance of a grassland system. So they're just a contributor, like many other species, to the whole tree. So this is just a bit of an illustration that we had done recently. It was done by an illustrator. What we were just really trying to highlight was kind of the above and below ground diversity that these badger burrows can really promote. So a nice range of vegetative communities, more mound species, and hopefully that healthier soil structure and nutrients from soils. Okay, so I'll just dive into a few facts on badger colonies. So the average, the average lifespan of a badger is 6 years. In the wild in captivity, they can live longer. I think they can be found to live for up 10 years if they're, in a zoo or something. They're generally solitary, like a lot of carnivores. But when they're in family groups, you'll definitely see them playing and rolling around. So there is some social behavior that like I said, especially when they're with the mother and siblings. So badgers usually mate in July and August. Badgers are quite cute when they're not little. And then they experience a delayed implantation into the early winter. So if they're healthy and fat, the egg will be fertilized in the early winter, and then they'll give birth in the spring, so around March and April, and they usually give birth to around 2 or 3 kicks, 3 or 3 young. Sometimes more if they're healthier, sometimes less. And a female is usually breeding the first year of her life. And so, just to talk about their home range sizes and density, even though they kind of have those short, stubby little legs as they're going along, they can move really far, and it's always surprised me to learn how far they can move. This really depends on resource availability and kind of the landscape and distribution. So if they're in an area where there's a lot of prey, they might not move very far, but if it's a little more patchy, they can their home range size will increase. So it ranges quite a bit. It's shown up here, it can go from anywhere from 200 to 300 square kilometers, so that's a pretty big difference in what the area they might occupy. And then the males will kind of circumnavigate the female territories, which are much smaller in range, up to from that 2 to only kind of 19 kilometers. So they persist in a much smaller area than each female. And then the dispersal distances for males during the mating season can double or can triple in size. When I was doing the work that I mentioned to you earlier, following monitoring badgers in BC, we had one male with a GPS backpack, and he went as the crow flew. highly motivated that evening. Lady. And then there's not, for density, there's not a lot of good information around prairie bred, as I mentioned. I don't think there's, I haven't really seen an estimation for density, so I just thought I would share that in kind of productive areas in Idaho, they found that there's about 2 to 6 badgers per square kilometer. So in a productive area, that might be what you would see. And badgers, as I suspect those of you that have badgers on your property, you know this, you see them in the winter, you see their digging in the winter. They're not true hibernators, so this is very similar to bears. They go through what's called torpor, not actually hibernation. A lot of people think like bears hibernate, but they just kind of go through this period of time in the winter where, you know, their heart rate and body temperature goes down a little bit, they rest. And particularly for a female badger who might become pregnant and have her kids in kind of the spring, she'll spend a lot more time in her burrow in the winter. It may not come up for a couple months or a few months, but the males will come up much more often. And they will dig hibernating ground squirrels up during the winter. So I'm not sure if anyone in the room has seen this. I would love to see this. It looks pretty fun. So there was a YouTube video a few years back that came out that kind of raised awareness around this relationship with people. Someone had a remote camera on a culvert, and there's a coyote that's standing there kind of waiting, looking over his shoulder, not going through the culvert. And then all of a sudden the badger shows up and they trot through the culvert together. It's really cute and funny. Kind of like this picture is trotting together. So what they found is that badgers and coyotes do hunt together quite often. And they really take advantage of each other's strategies of hunting. So while a badger is trying to dig out a ground squirrel, that ground squirrel might pop up in a hole over here and then the coyote takes it. Or ground squirrel is distracted by a coyote and the badger will. So they kind of utilize each other's strengths. And they have found that I don't know if anyone's done this for badgers, but coyotes can apparently catch at least a third more prey while they're hunting with coyotes or with badgers. So pretty good more. Okay, so just kind of switching gears. I thought I'd touch really quickly the main threats to badgers. Sort of as I mentioned, particularly in the more westerly or easterly provinces of BC, Wyoming to Ontario, the biggest threats to badgers there is loss of large intact grasslands, native prairie. A lot of these areas, like this is the picture taken in BC on the right, and there was actually a really nice number of badgers on this ranch, and so it's going up for sale. It's going to be developed into a subdivision, so that's pretty impactful. And then a lot of these systems, the highways are getting busier, there's more highways being built, and there's a lot of road mortality, especially when you've kind of got ideal grassland habitat on both sides of the road and they'll be going back and forth. The other thing they often do is they burrow right next to the roads. It's kind of easy to dig out from these ground squirrels there, so that sort of positions them to be a bad spot on the road. And then, of course, over time, extirpation of ground squirrel populations, secondary poisoning, and shooting. But I think overall, the first two are probably the leading causes in a lot of areas for them. But that's sort of the list of threats to these species. Okay, true or false? Badgers are nocturnal. False. I assume most people in this room get that right. Badgers are dangerous. Yes, this is true. Some people are pretty scared of them. Like, you know, unless you corner them, they're going to go into their burrow. In their burrow. messaging going around that badgers are carriers of bovine tuberculosis, TB. This is not true. This is false. European badgers are known to carry this, so there are concerns about this in Europe. No, there's no evidence in North American badgers to carry bovine TB. So just if you do hear that, it's not the case for these guys. And then another one is always kind of the sticky one around whether or not badgers cause kind of really significant damage either to machinery or injury to livestock. Again, this is something we really don't know very much about, and that's where you guys come in. This was a research project and a survey was done in BC, just trying to get an understanding of like how much damage a badger can cause to machinery or what the risk is for livestock. Just to try and kind of support people living with badgers and get a sense for what the realized risk of having a badger on your property is. In BC, they interviewed, I think it was 131 cattle ranchers, and of the 131, it was 1% of respondents attributed livestock injury to a badger burrow. That being said, we spoke about this earlier in Belmarie, and a woman said her cow stepped into a burrow last week and broke its leg, so, but she's never had that happen before. So it happens, but it's just nice to understand what kind of that realized risk is for everyone. So living with badgers, kind of some suggested best management practices. These are coming from organization in Alberta called Multisar, so I'm sort of adopting these from their recommendations. So one of his is manage your vegetation. So if you have an area of concern where you really don't want badgers, you don't want those big holes, you don't want those big soil mounds, one strategy is that you could have let your vegetation grow a little bit taller in those areas, mostly because that reduces chance of having ground squirrels there. It's less likely to have those small mammals that don't like the taller grasses. Because where you have good numbers of ground squirrels and small mammals, prairie dogs, then that's when the badgers come in. That's their preferred prey. So you're kind of managing them around reducing the suitability of habitat for that small mammal. Another recommended practice is to support other predators such as raptors. These are predators on both badgers and ground squirrels, so that kind of reduces both. So, you know, putting up woody areas that are suitable for raptors is a good stretch. Tolerance, where and if possible, particularly when during the maternal period, when they have their young with them. So when they're rearing young, they're most sensitive between April and August. Kind of that April 15th, mid-April to mid-August is sort of their more sensitive time. So during that time, if possible, some things that are suggested is to consider where your livestock concentrations are. If you do think you have a family, you see more than one together, maybe there's a chance that you could, change where you've got water, salt licks, or that kind of thing. And then machine operations, if you can adjust where you're moving your machinery, right, and kind of where that family group is, that's one way that you can reduce impacts to them. So there's a couple of suggestions. And this is kind of what I mentioned at the start. So this is where, folks that are living on the land with them, if you have any suggestions or ideas or experiences that you've had, kind of all ears. Yeah, there's no perfect strategy to try and kind of coexist with them. So any feedback is really great, appreciated. Okay, these are just what I thought I'd do is really quickly go through this. So at the start of the talk, I mentioned that I worked on research projects. back in DC. So just to let you guys know, kind of really high level, how people collect information on badgers, just kind of fun insights. So kind of the traditional techniques is observational, or you could use VHF telemetry. VHF is radio telemetry, but you actually had to put the radio unit in the body cavity, which is pretty invasive. So new strategies, you can use remote cameras, you can do some hair sampling, or you can use a GPS backpack. So the remote camera monitoring kind of looks like this. So there's a family group on the left, and there's a badger going through a crossing structure. Great. For hair sampling, you can put, these are, I always forget what these are called, but basically what they are is, I guess, the carpet to stay down.
Velcro?
Kind of like that. Yes, because it. And so you fix that onto the top of the burrow. When they go in and out of the burrow, it catches their hair, and then you can send that in, and you can for DNA sampling, and you can get an individual ID from them. And this is what the backpacks look like. So kind of neat to see. They were actually adopted from migratory birds. But this is just kind of funny. So this is the radio unit, and that's a GPS unit. And because they were designed originally for migratory birds, they weren't designed for an animal that smashes through roots and rocks. So the first crack at this wasn't super successful, and this came on pretty fast. So there's a really expensive unit in the bottom of a burrow. So they had to improve the glue on those. Okay, lastly, what I just thought I'd share with you, this is taken from a BC Badger website, and it's just to share with folks, if you're wondering if you have a badger burrow, or these are badger burrows on your property, kind of what the differences are between, you know, what a coyote den looks like, badger den looks like. So badger burrows are, I'm sure you're familiar, but they're kind of more elliptical in shape, very much mimicking the shape of a badger. That square head versus the coyote is more rectangular and tall. So it just kind of gives some descriptions on this card of what you're looking for if you're wondering if it is a badger burrow or a den used by another animal. There's that plugged badger burrow that I mentioned at the start, when you kind of refill it. So what I mentioned, there's some stickers and brochures on the table, but the stickers got a website link for a Prairie Badger website. This is something that we're working on, and we hope to have done by the end of March. And what this website hopes to do is just basically provide a place for any of you that are interested or anyone else to go to the website and kind of find out information sort of like I've described. Have a couple of links to landowner surveys and stuff like that. So just a resource for information. So I just thought I'd mention that because this, like I said, this is